Do you see with more than your eyes? Do you meet someone and feel their aura? Do you visualize things? Is it difficult? And the one question I did not ask, but I wish I did, how does he decide what to wear? Will he be alone? Our eyes functionally let us see, but I guess to really see and feel, you need more than your eyes. You need a beautiful soul and a big canvas to paint. You can choose to make it as beautiful or as ugly as you want. These are the lines from the blog titled Being Specially Able, A Whole New Perspective by none other than Shalini Saraswati. A round of applause. We have with us a very special guest, and there's nothing more that I can say. It's very hard for me to actually introduce her. There's so much that's happening in me, so I'll try and contain my energy and enthusiasm as much as possible. She's a para-athlete. She is a blade runner. In 2016, she becomes the world TCS 10 kilometers runner, a marathon runner. Won a bronze medal for 100 meter sprint at 2018 National Para-Athletic Championship. I think, what can we say? Currently, she is Asia's number three under T62 category. And also, she's also training for 2020 Summer Paralympics. She is also a motivational speaker and a blogger too. Ladies and gentlemen, she also lives by no conditions apply. To make us use this opportunity and to learn and imbibe, we have a Q&A session with Shalini Saraswati. We would want to really know as to how you see yourself in a few years, what are the things that you would like to do so that more and more people can get inspired. Before we move on, I'd like to ask you something about your background.
Okay.
And so tell us something about where you're from, schooling, basically.
So I'm a Malayali by DNA. My parents are from Kerala, but I grew up in Bangalore. So a heart Kannadiga. My initial schooling, college was everything in Bangalore, and Bangalore girl always. So I did schooling, got through work. I first joined work in 2000. I feel like, you know, decade old talking about the times now, but yes. And then I was one of those people that started off very early in the BPO industry when it took off, mm-hmm. which is business process outsourcing, yes. which is pretty much call centers in your language. Yes. And I was one of the lucky people who started my career very early when it started. So we were one of the first few people who took the night shift cabs, and, you know, parents around us would tell my parents that, you know, you might want to watch out, your daughter's up to something fishy. She goes late night and comes back really late hours in a fishy cab. So we went through that, but the advantage of joining the BPO industry as well is that growth came very early for a lot of us, because we were part of a very nascent industry. So with that, you know, your career and all of that grew. And, you know, I think I've been very blessed all my life. I've had a fairly decent, touch wood, good life.
How was your schooling?
We were just talking about it earlier today, because I was one of those people that teachers always said that, you know, Shalini is a bad influence. So, you know, watch out, or if any of the things that my friends did, though they were completely responsible for it, and it was their decision at multiple points in their life, for whatever reasons, I was blamed for it. So that was pretty much my childhood. But I was academically doing well. I was into like dance and music and debate and all of that. So so quite a boisterous child, and I always had the fun element in wanting to, you know, live life well, kind of.
And explore.
Yeah, and explore. And I think also sometimes it's sometimes also about what your parents let you grow up to be. And I think one of the advantages that I've always had is having very supportive parents who've let you become as independent as you can. There was never a thing that you are the girl child and therefore, you know, you need to be protected, or you cannot do X, Y, and Z, or you can do X, Y, Z. I think I was always given the freedom to do what I want to do and be what I wanted to be. And maybe that gives you a certain amount of confidence in the way that you grew up, and even with having to deal with life situations.
True. It's very important. We understand that you had encountered something almost fatal in Cambodia. For the audience's sake, could you tell us something about it?
So it's called rickettsial with moths, and it's apparently very rare. It's a bacteria. It comes out of dog ticks apparently, and I'm a dog lover, and I mean it. So I must have, like, when I was at Cambodia, like, I would have, like, I petted like multiple dogs, and I might have picked it up out of them. But the thing with India is that it's not necessarily a bacteria that's very known, or it's not that people really know a lot about. So when we did come back, I was fine for almost a month. So the bacteria had a lot of time to kind of be happy within my system, and you know, we peacefully coexisted for about a month or more. And then it decided that, hey, you know, we're not having enough fun and we need to make this more fun. So that's when we decided to go down the fatal route. And when we went in again, the symptoms were pretty much dengue malaria, because I had very high fever, I was shivering, and my platelet count was really low. And so obviously we started off with treatment for dengue and malaria, because that's what we thought it was. But we took a really long time, but by that time I went into a multi-organ failure. My heart stopped beating twice, my lung was filled with water, and I was given like hardly any chance of survival. I think the doctors had pretty much written me off, and had even told my family that I wasn't going to make it, and anybody who needs to see her should come and see her at this point in time. Of course, like, I didn't know of any of the drama, I kind of slept through the whole thing. But I guess it was the people around that struggled more than me. When I woke up, I survived it, because I didn't kind of want to die, I think. Or the other theory where we have is, like, we went up and then the person upstairs said that, listen, you know, I can't deal with you right now, so I think you need to spend more time back down there.
I think that's true.
That could be the thing, yeah. And so we were here, and when I woke up, of course, I had no idea about what had happened. But I did see that both my hands and legs had turned a dark blue-black, and there was huge swelling in them. But, like, you know, I just thought it was going to become all right. Like, you don't get into a hospital with fever, which you thought was dengue or malaria, and anything, you know, yes. You're going to get a yes. few medication. And then, you know, we also live in times where we believe in miracles. We True. Believe, you know, True. We all watch way too many Bollywood movies where, you know, somebody's going to ring that temple bell in the thing, and then the flower's going to fall off the god, and then I'm going to, like, miraculously get up and walk up. Yeah, we were all hoping for that moment to happen, yes. but we realized that, you know, it didn't happen in real life. I was told at that point in time that there was a very likely chance that I might have to get amputated, but we didn't believe in it, like, because we just thought that there had to be, like, some miracle somewhere. That would happen. And we tried Ayurveda, we tried the whole drama, and I managed to fracture this one sometime in between, because I'd started to work while I was unwell, and I would tap on a laptop for very long. And I managed to fracture this one, so then we had to amputate this one. And about 6 months later, this one dramatically just fell off. And when that happened was when we kind of knew that maybe, you know, we kind of knew that there was, that was like the point where we knew that there was no miracle happening. Like, maybe this falling off was the miracle that we needed to really push us forward in life. And we went ahead and amputated both the legs. So that's like pretty much the medical journey that we had.
I know it's a medical journey, but when certain things happen to you, especially like this, what went on in your mind when they said all these things to you, that, and you knew that almost you felt, no, there is a way. So probably you're very strong, therefore you looked for that hope.
Yeah, probably, yeah. Yeah, like, you can look at it whichever way. We were yes. either stupid or like we could have done this long ago, amputated and moved on with our lives.
Yes.
But I also think that there's sometimes a time and a place and a journey that sometimes gets you to a point. I feel like maybe if I had amputated right at the start in 2012, I wouldn't have coped as well as I did today. Because it would have been a bigger shock. It would have been that my life came to a complete abrupt end and I had no say in it. But I think having waited for almost 1.5, 2 years, it got me to the point where I truly believed that amputation was the best decision for me, and it was a decision that I took. And it made me feel probably a bit more empowered, and it also made me feel that, you know, the decision wasn't so bad a decision, yeah. because okay. I had spent 2 years in bed, right? I saw four walls for 2 years of my life. And the only time I moved out of the room was when someone would physically carry me on to watch television or back, or to the balcony and back. So, but with that, I think, you know, you somehow realize that this is not the life that you want. And then amputation seemed like a fantastic decision to take.
What an amazing woman. I think you should really clap for her. Amidst all this, there's something that I really wouldn't want to ask, and this is very, very strongly, I wanted to really ask this. There is a lot of stigma attached to disability, and you said in an interview, people expect you to be sad and very hopeless at home and wait that, you know, nothing can happen in life. Why did you say that?
Well, I'm just saying, like, if you, all of you all in this room, if you all think about anybody with a disability, right, what are the first set of images that come through your head? Anybody?
Anybody?
Sympathy, right? You typically have, you know, if you look at the newspaper, you would have somebody in a wheelchair and that's about, you know, polio drops, for example. It either that, or, you know, you have where we're talking about children, all of, you know, that gamut that we cover. Or then you have the other end where you have somebody with a single leg standing on some mountain, and then, you know, you have this cheesy line, the only disability is the disability in the mind, and, you know, stuff like that. Or, you know, about overly inspirational, right? Those are two extremes, and there's nothing in between.
Yes.
Right? You're either going to be somebody who is feeling terrible, yes, about the place that you are in, or you have to be somebody who is extremely accomplished. We don't talk about, we don't normalize disability. Like, we don't normalize it to be a part of our normal life.
Yes.
Like, I always say this in all my talks, like, everybody in this room who's wearing glasses or spectacles are disabled, right? Because your eyes do not function at the level that it should, and yes, that's a disability. But we don't consider your disability. Like, you're not, nobody's going to tell you that I don't give you a job, other than you're a pilot, I think. You know, all other jobs you're going to get.
True.
And the point is that the reason why we don't look at it as a disability is that because we, you know, in your college, you have a lecturer who wears glasses and teaches you, right? You go see your doctor who wears glasses and he's a doctor.
Yes.
It normalizes it and you don't see it any differently. And that is exactly what it is. Like, so even when you came into this room today to have this conversation with me, you probably didn't expect what you're seeing today. Yeah? You were expecting somebody a lot more sober and who was going to talk to you like this.
There's a lot of silence in the audience.
And feel this way about it. You know, I'm thinking that's what it was. And unfortunately, that is the image, constant imagery that we have around disability, or even about the fact that you want to dress up and look nice,
yes,
right?
Yes.
You don't expect, I met a group of girls the other day and we were having the same conversation. And it was a group of blind girls in this organization at Dell, I think. And we were talking later, and there was this one girl who had a polio leg, and she walks on a crutch. And she said, I bought this skirt some time back, but I wouldn't wear it because I just thought that, you know, I wear the skirt and somebody's going to say, Mudle kaal illa, avalge ishtu jamba nodu skirt pere hakon hoktale, in Kannada. Like, I hope everybody understands it. For the ones who don't, it's like, you know, she doesn't have a leg,
yes,
and look at how, you know, smart ass she wants to wear a skirt. And that is what it is, that you don't expect them,
yes,
to. And she said, you know, I'm going to go back and wear it tomorrow because I know that it's something that I'm allowed to do, either for my own self and even for the way you view it. So I really think it's important to break that stereotype that we have.
I deliberately asked this question because when I was going through her interviews earlier and her blogs, what struck to me was this, and that is, I've also had a few friends who were supposedly disabled. I really wouldn't want to call them disabled. They were extremely strong, and they had all the strength in the world to do anything. And we, supposed to be normal, we would, you know, give up so easily and say, hey, no, it's okay. But she would, you know, there's somebody named Ramya Aital. She was my classmate, and I was just telling my senior here that she too had immense strength. So my question is, do you need something to happen to have strength? Do you really need to go down that or jump off that cliff? Do you need that? Do you feel that?
Well, I think you having that moment makes you realize it whether you have it or not, right? If life doesn't test you, you don't get to really know whether you have it or not. I think that everybody,
yes,
does have,
yes,
have it. But I think we're all a creature of the circumstances that we're,
yes,
born, the circumstances that we grow in, the function of our families and friends that we are and that molds us as a person. And I think, and therefore then that strength comes into play depending on what those other circumstances that got you to that point. So, and that becomes the point where you choose to use the strength or choose not to, right? So that strength, I think, is inherent in everyone. I think we're all born with it.
Yes.
And then along the line, then life happens and we decide how that molds us as a person to become strong or not. But I think what happens, the other thing that I feel when you talk about an adversity that happening to you or that moment where you fall off the cliff, is that it, I think what makes a lot of people strong sometimes is that it teaches all of us how frivolous our lives are, right? About we go through our lives thinking about how important our lives is. About you know having this education now. I mean, you should get an education, but yeah, wrong thing to say. But you know getting that degree that we've all aspired for, get that college, you know, go to that dream college, get that dream job, get that dream car, get that dream house. And then when you have a severe adversity where it's between life and death, or you figure out that none of those things matter at all, and maybe that makes you that changes you as a person.
I like what you said, life happens. So when life happens, don't wait, ladies and gentlemen, to you know, really have that life happens. You ran a 10-kilometer marathon.
It's not a marathon, it's just 10 kilometers.
Okay.
Marathon is 42.
All right.
Which none of us
you correct
to.
Almost all the interviews whenever such questions were asked. All you've been through and you still ran.
Hmm.
Why running and what made you choose running?
I didn't choose running. Like running chose me, one, and I think coach happened. So I think the first time I ran with a lot of duress and coercion because I just think like it was coach's obsession to start off with. I didn't believe it was possible. I didn't think that it was a sensible thing to do. I mean, who runs 10 kilometers? Like why? You know, so I don't think, but I definitely think that along the way, while it was somebody else's dream for me, I think along the way, I really enjoyed it. I've said this before as well, that perhaps running is one of the only things that I can do without anybody's help.
Yes, you did say
right?
that.
Right, once I put on my blades, then there's no, I don't need help to do with every other thing in my life. If I need to drink a glass of water, then somebody will have to do that for me. But with running, I don't. So it became one of those things that, it became my thing. Right? And also I think there's something that happens in your head, right? When you are not meant to do a lot of things in your life. Like for me, doing small things like sitting in a chair, getting off a chair, walking a few steps, or eating my own food in itself is a huge accomplishment. In that condition, then being able to run 10 kilometers was really pushing my body to extremes. And when you're able to accomplish that, for me, I think it got me to derive a sense of worth from it for my own self. Because I think at that point in time, I'd become this, I had almost become very not confident about the person that I had become. Because you obviously had a lot to deal with. You had to deal with the fact that you missed limbs. You had to deal with the fact that you didn't look like the same person that you needed to. That your entire life had altered. I didn't know if I could even go back to an old job. I didn't know if people would deal with me the same way. I didn't know if I could do all of the thousand things that I might have done before. So for me, being able to do this, it became almost a reiteration, or it became somehow it sanctified me being alive and saying to myself that, you know, I think we're going to be okay. Like, you know, I think I can deal. For me, I think sometimes when I ran the 10 kilometers, it became about if I can do this 10 kilometers, I can deal with the rest of my life. And that's about it, and that's how we ran the first madness. And then we ran the second time because I hated the timing that I... The first one was an awful race. I don't know how many of you knew it. Like, y'all only knew about, like, me finishing the race, but that entire mid part was, like, total drama because at the sixth hour, I'm, like, I was severely dehydrated, my blood pressure had dropped, and, you know, I walked, ran, and then I had, like... I think what was really funny was we were running with my coach and all of them, and there were a lot of these elderly people. So when you do the 10-kilometer race in Bangalore, you run through a place called Cubbon Park, right? And Cubbon Park has a lot of elderly people that come in for walks. So all these elderly people were giving really dirty looks to my coach and everybody to say, why are you doing this to this child? and then, you know, at some point in time, I was so bad that there was this old man, I really remember, he comes and he gives me this cashew, badam and all, and he's like, kodamma, eat ma, eat. So he was hoping that that would get me through the finish line, and like at some point he kept looking at these people to say, why are you doing this to this girl? So, you know, it, the whole journey, but also that makes you realize that sometimes, you know, you just have a lot of other cheerleaders in your life that you don't really see.
Yes.
But there are people that are always cheering for you, and sometimes it's important to recognize those people along the way as well, because they get you through some of the journeys that you probably think you'd never get through.
Very true. Since this lecture series is initiated to spread awareness about organ donation, do you have any opinion on the relevance of organ donation that can help someone?
Absolutely. I think once we die, we're of no use to anybody, and I feel like you should just give all of your body parts. What are you going to do with it anyways? Right?
May I just say that I think I'll speak for you. We all love you already. So that leads to another question. Did you ever think of the organ transplant?
Oh yes, the hand transplant. So my Ayurvedic doctor was a huge proponent of it, because it had happened in Amrita Medical College.
Okay.
And there were two hand transplants.
Yes.
And
yes.
He constantly spoke to me about it, and he sent me these videos, he sent me numbers of the doctors who did it.
Mm-hmm.
I'm unsure about it.
Okay.
Because one is that I know that you'll have to be on immunosuppressants, and which means a life that I go back for a certain period in time.
All right.
And I just feel that I've taken 10 steps forward. I'm not in the mood to take 2 steps back.
Back.
Plus I just feel that, you know, you'll have to get, like, having somebody else's hand on me, and like, what if it's one of those sci-fi movies where the hand has a mind of its own? Right? Like, have you considered that? Like, you know, you've seen those movies where they put the eyes of the person and then they go back to the previous janma and they're able to see things, right? So I constantly think that that's going to happen to me, or I'm saying that if I'm going to get like a white man's hand or a white woman's hand. So, you know, it kind of like totally, it has to be something dramatic in whichever way. So I just think somehow I think that whole sci-fi movie thing might happen in, to me. Like, it's a possibility. So I'm not sure as yet if I want to do it at this point in time. Yeah.
I see a lot of...
No, but you should. I mean, but anybody else who considers that organ transplant is important, please do it, okay? Like, don't get into this whole second janma thing now.
No, I think...
unscientific thing to say in a scientific place.
I think, Shalini, I think all of you will agree when I say this. This very interesting sense of humor that she has. Not all of us, you know, I think, you know, when I started off, there were a couple of areas that I was really enjoying what you were saying, because I really appreciate sense of humor. Some of you know me very well, but I did not see the audience really take it. But now I see that, now they really understand who she is. I think I'm very glad the audience has understood it. Round of applause for yourself. Very interestingly, I found your blogs written really well. I'm from literature background, and some of us are as well. My senior faculty is here. When you write, there's so much of depth. But why writing? Why did you choose writing now? Or did the writing choose you?
No, I think for 2 years I was in bed, right? I didn't have a lot to do. Like, how much do you watch TV? How much do you write books? And there's also a lot of anger, because you're really sometimes in dark places. And I think sometimes for me a great vent was to write, because it gave me a place to really put all my dark, ugly thoughts in a place which nobody should ever hear of. And it gave me a place to really vent, which was where a lot of the dark poetry comes, which is not online, obviously. Because, you know, then it doesn't go well with the personality that you're seeing right now. You know, that's like alter ego types. So it gave me that release that it did. And I also read somewhere that sometimes, you know, when you write all of your anger, that it's transference, right? You're in some ways letting go of your anger.
Yes, yes.
Towards life, and generally everybody who had hands and limbs at that point in time. So it happened, and then I think there was, when I started then the blog came through and a lot of people told me that I should blog. And I mean, I used to write even otherwise, but I used to write pretty much greeting cards and all that types. For those of you who didn't know that it existed, there were greeting cards long, long time ago where you send birthday wishes to people. And then the blog happened and it became almost therapeutic when I wrote the first blog. I remember like crying when I wrote the blog, and then every time I checked grammar, which was about 3 or 4 times, I cried all over again. And so it gave me, it was therapeutic in a lot of ways. And the first time it was out, then I had like just like a whole barrage of feedback that came through. And then there were a lot of people in there who wrote, there were women who had breast cancer. There were people who had, who were women who had lost children.
Yes.
And just a whole lot of people that wrote back that said that, you know, that blog gave them strength. And it made me understand that, you know, this is a two-way street, right? While it heals me, it heals other people. And that's exactly how I ended up writing. But then I'm very lazy about it. And I sometimes, I have to find, like you said, it's deep. Sometimes I have to really find the depth to be able to write something that's moved me. And nothing's moved me in a really long time.
Yes, I see like, only a few.
Yeah,
now.
Very few.
Yes.
Like I think really like 5 blogs, and then it's like really hard. Like I have to think through a lot to write. And sometimes I think writing should come from here.
Yes, yes. Writing cannot come just like that. It's not.
I would make a really bad author because it would be a half-finished book, I think.
We might as well read a half-finished book. Speaking of reading and writing, is there a book that remains with you? Because you write very well. And the language construction is really good. So that comes from an English teacher.
I like it.
So is there any book that remains with you? Or an author that remains with you?
Not really. I'd like to read across the length and breadth of things.
But you read a lot when...
I read a lot. A lot of people ask me if I read like self-help motivation books. And honestly, I was reading 50 Shades of Grey. I didn't know, so it was kind of not really, it could be motivational, but, children in the audience, sorry, thanks girls. How old is the audience, sorry?
There are children, but I think they are...
School, right? Okay,
yes.
Sorry. Can we retract that? I read a lot. I read fiction, actually. I read a lot of fiction. So there was different genres across the length and breadth of it. But no self-motivation because I needed escape.
Yes.
I didn't want anybody to tell me how to improve my life.
Yes.
Because I just felt like, you know, you don't know what life is.
Yes.
So it was a lot of fiction because I really needed an escape. But I really enjoy a lot of, nowadays especially, a lot of Indian authors. I like the Devdutt Patnaiks of the world. Yeah.
Questions are often asked of your incident and challenges. Mm. What makes you share your story? Especially, you've come all the way here, and you've spent quite a lot of... yesterday, we saw you going to Marina, looking at each and everything with your friends here. And I see, I saw you very excited about everything. So that's very nice. It's very hard to come by people who are excited about everything in life. Everybody is saying...
Okay, disorder as well.
All right. So, well, ladies and gentlemen, sense of humor. I hope you understood that. So what makes you share these experiences with us?
Initially, obviously, I didn't see the power in it at all. And I just felt like I didn't want to put my world out there. But like I said, the first blog made a lot of difference. And then when you've consistently done talks, it's great when you have someone who comes back, gives you a long hug or has tears in their eyes and tells you that, listen, I think I can deal with the rest of my life. I think those moments make you realize that what you do is help somebody else. And Amma always says, it's not about you sometimes. It's sometimes about what somebody else can get from you. And I also learned that sometimes doing these helps me as well, because sometimes I get these really great questions that gets me to question my own thoughts and beliefs and what I see and what I do not see in my own perceptions. So then it becomes a learning for me as well. So I guess that's why I kind of like to do what I do. But wanting to come to Mangalore was clearly a very straight decision because it has fish and prawns and seafood. So the whole reason why we even said yes when they said Manipal Mangalore, first thing was, yes, we get to eat great seafood, let's go. And then, oh, by the way, there's the marathon and everything as well. So, yeah.
So in any case, fish brought us somebody very special. Since you are a runner, tell us something about your experience training for the first time. I'm sure it would...
Oh, it was awful. Like, I don't know why I do it, but... I'm in the stadium at 6:30 in the morning every day, Monday through Saturday. It's tough. Like, yeah, my coach is like he's a nice guy, but he's hard. I like the way, like, he's kind of refreshing because he cares. I can't use language as well. So he cares a damn about the fact that I'm disabled or I might find it difficult to run. Like, so I could be in telling him that, you know, real, and I sometimes pull the one, like, to say, you know, the blade's hurting or whatever. And he says, no, you just finish it. That's about it.
So he's not kind to you?
No, he's not. He's not kind. Like, unless I'm, like, really having tears in my eyes, it very rarely moves him.
Okay.
So otherwise, everything else he'll say, well, just finish it and then you can deal with it later on. So I guess that was refreshing, and like I always said, that I'm somebody who likes to be challenged. I like to be pushed sometimes, and yes, that kind of gets my inner, that inner person that gets, oh, okay, I'm going to do this type. So,
becomes very crucial for...
Yes, I think I would have been very lazy otherwise. Like, I would have just been happy doing some basic things in life and...
What was the day like for you when you ran that 10K, and how did you feel?
So, interesting. So, the day, so I, like, honestly, like, when I decided to run 10 kilometers, I didn't think it was a big deal, honestly. Like, I didn't think of a future like this today. Right? It was never the aspiration. It was never that I wanted to become a motivational speaker or I wanted to do this because 10 people would say, oh, wow. Like, it wasn't like that at all. So it was just something that we thought we will do. We did it. And even when I've spoken to my friends about it, everyone's like, okay, you're training. Fine. Let's do this. Whatever. I don't think even they said that, oh, you know, Shahz, this is fantastic and, you know, you're going to be so inspiring. Like, you know, I don't think they even cared. And I think they were more happy that they get to eat free food at the end of the marathon.
Is it true, by the way?
Yeah, they all were there. They were all there and they just came and then I was dying there and they all just ate breakfast and left. So you know, we didn't think through it at all. And we were running, we were practicing, and then there was somebody who came and said that, listen, somebody wanted to interview you and the TCS guys. And we said, sure, whatever. And that's, they came, they met us up and they did some fancy video. And again, we're thinking that, yeah, like, whatever. And after that, we had like two journalists who came and spoke to us, Times and the Deccan. And so we had this again, this whole conversation. And like, so in your head, you're thinking sports magazine, like sports page, last page, that last, second last page, 1 3x3, you know, that small one thing will be there, one photograph probably. So we're expecting that. So I walked in next day to the stadium. I haven't even looked at the newspaper. And then there are newspapers, everybody's going, Shahz, newspaper, and I'm like, what? So when we opened, we're on the first page. And that's when I think like, oh, we are front page news. Like, really, like, people don't have anything else
by
to talk about.
Are.
Like, yeah, but that's the whole point. Like, I didn't see the big deal with it, right?
Yes.
And even today, sometimes I don't see the big deal with it. And so we did all of this, and then the media broke loose because suddenly, like, Kahipe, you know, Mars, we are landing on Chandrayaan is happening, and then we had like a whole barrage of media coming up telling us yeh wo drama. So what had happened, I think, by the time race day had happened, was I was under huge pressure. Because there was just way too many people that was looking at me to want to succeed. So when we started off the race, there was also the camera angle involved, they wanted us right at the front of the start line, which is not a smart decision, especially if you're on blades.
Yes.
Right? People weren't thinking sensibly, neither was I, because we didn't have too much of experience either. So once we started the race, we realized that the human nature of wanting to compete and not being empathetic and sensible to other people on blades happen, right? Because then it's a mad rush because everybody is wanting to push. Then we realize that there are also a whole set of human beings who are selfie crazed, right? So I'm running, and then I have somebody who walks up right in front of me, flashes out their phone and wanted to take a picture of me in the background. Then when we're running halfway through, the media comes in with one camera in my face. How are you feeling while running? I am dying. that is what is happening. I am dying. But you can't really say that. Right? You're saying like, yes, yes, this is good. So that's what's happening. And then we hit this. So by this time, like, I'm under huge pressure, obviously. So when I did reach the 6 kilometer mark, I had died. It was also a very, very, very humid day. Like, and to be honest, and you can check this, Kenyans were fainting, so it's not really my fault. And so at 6 kilometer mark, I don't know, like, we checked, did a time check, and I was already, I think it was already an hour by then. And I, at that point in time, I was extremely upset with myself because we were looking at an hour and 45. So I knew that I wouldn't do the next 4 and 45 minutes. So I was very angry with myself and I was very disappointed with myself. Right. And I remember even actually sitting down at one point and saying, listen, I'm going to give up. Okay. Let's just get this done with and go. Because I just felt like I had let down so many people. And I also had this conversation like, how am I going to go back and face anybody? Which is a stupid thing to
do. No, it is not.
Yeah. And then, like, you know, coach said that, listen, we're not going to give up. Let's just walk. Yes. Drink some water. We'll walk. So we walked. And then I had to have this whole self-talk to myself to really ask the question that, you know, who are we doing this for?
Yes.
Right? Are we doing this for other people or are we doing this for myself? And somewhere the answer did come that I'm doing this for my own self. Because if I do this, then I'm fine. Nobody else matters. And that's when we began to push ourselves and got through the race. You know, like, and that's what even we've said this, like, my friends were all waiting for me at the finish line, right? So they, in their head and even in my head, my image is that last 100 meters, you know, you're running and you're waving at people. So that's what is going on. So even they're expecting it. And I'm coming, like, when I had two people holding on to me, like, practically dragging me through the finish line. And then, of course, we went and we ate a lot, which was a bad idea after running a marathon. We fainted, like I was like kind of out for some time. I couldn't comprehend what was going on because my blood pressure had really dropped. But I think funnily, what I was also doing at that point was that my mind was still telling that, you know, what are we doing? We got to stay conscious. So I just had this like doped look on my face where I'm just like this and I kept staring at everybody across. And then at the point when they started asking me questions and I couldn't answer was when everybody panicked. Okay. And then we went to the hospital again. And then when I woke up, I didn't know what had happened, right? So I woke up and all hospitals have this similar roof, right?
Yes.
So I'm looking at it and I'm saying, oh shit, we're back at the same place. Oh no, not again.
Not again.
And then I woke up, looked, checked both my hands, moved them quietly and I said, oh, it works. Great. And then we woke up. So yeah, so that was race day. Very, not very glamorous, like that whole video that you all saw, but...
I think it is very, I really don't know how you put this forward, but it's truly hard to go through something like that. I have to confess something here. I know Shalini might not really like it, but you know what, when we look at people like Shalini, there's a lot of sympathy and admiration at the same time. When I approached her, when I saw her for the first time, I was extremely proud of her. I hadn't known her, I hadn't even spoken to her, but I was extremely proud of her. I think all of us are very proud of her. Please, very, very proud of you. You have a very interesting sense of humor, so, and very good command over language, so you almost try and construct certain sentences in a way that you don't even understand the hardship that you went through. That's commendable. That's really, really commendable. Now, there is a very interesting question I'd like to ask you. There are a lot of people, when especially women celebrities, there was Scarlett Johansson was asked this question when the others were also there, Iron Man, Spider-Man, Superman, so many others. And Scarlett, I'd like to call her Scarlett Johansson for certain reasons. Now, she was. They were asked a lot of questions. Like, how did you prepare for the role? To the men, how did you prepare for the role and was it very hard? So they all answered in a particular way, in depth. And when it came to Scarlett Johansson, they asked, so how, what did you do for your diet?
Yeah.
Now that made her really upset. Why are you asking me about diet when you've asked all the male counterparts about the character roles? Now, I'd like to ask you this question. Is it different being a woman when certain things have happened and you are a runner today?
Yeah.
You have various challenges to face. So is it really different being a woman?
Yeah, I think it's... I think it's there's a more sympathy factor because yo hudki ala like papa aurat hai kya kar ab lanari types and I think it is obviously because they think I think if I was unmarried then it would be that yo who's going to marry her, right?
Yes.
Because somehow our life seems to be defined by marriage as women, right? Like if we didn't get married and we didn't have children, we somehow don't meet the criteria of being a woman at all. So yes, I think it is. I think being married now, I think the perception always is about, I think, and I've said this in the past, my husband hates it, but he gets a lot more of credit than I do, right? Because he's the man who stood by this whole woman and he did not leave her at all, right? But when if the roles were reversed, right, if the man had become disabled, and if the wife was all right, it would become her dharma to look after the man, right? It's an expectation that we have of the woman. Like if she left the man at that point in time, she becomes the woman who was selfish, that she thought she wanted another life that didn't have to deal with disability, right? But when the man decides to stay back, it is about, oh my God, what a self-sacrificial man he is, because he let go of all his wants and desires and decided to stay with the woman. And there's also a theory that, you know, maybe you should let him have another marriage because, you know, Papa, he has needs that need to be looked after. And I'm not joking. I was seriously said this. Like, I've had people have this conversation with me who said that, you know, I think, you know, your husband's very sweet, but, you know, have you considered getting him married again? Because, you know, he needs somebody that will be his wife. And then, you know, and then they gave me another bonus answer as well. See, and also in your old age, you have somebody to look after you. Like, I was like, oh, brilliant. So I said, no, very nice. I said, I think I love the idea. I said, you look, if you have anybody, if you have a daughter or anybody in your family that you want to get my husband married to, we'll get them married too, right? And then they haven't come back, obviously, because they're not going to give their daughter to him. But I think definitely there's a perspective with which we look at. I think women are more meant to go through more hardships, because obviously, you know, you're not going to be able to procreate, you're not going to be able to get married, so all of those, so you're in bigger hardships if you're disabled. I think that is the perception.
I wanted to ask you this question only because of this, and there are a lot of challenges that we go through, and it's very hard for me also personally. Sometimes even I wonder, is it the same for men? Is it different for women? It's very hard for me to even... So I really wanted to find out as to, is it different for you?
No, I'm sure that even men with disabilities have their own challenges, right? Like, because you become less of a man.
Yes, yes.
Right?
True,
I'm sure that's a difficulty for them to deal with as well, because, you know, you're somehow thinking that you're not going to be the stud that you're meant to be. And that's probably difficult even for a man to deal with, you know. And obviously even they can't get married and all of that. Or, you know, somebody's going to say that you marry some girl from a poor family who's going to be okay with it.
I think stereotypes have to be considered before we even think about it. Well, what are your goals for the future?
I don't like goals because you really don't know if it exists or the goalpost changes. I think the only aspiration, and I use the word aspiration, is the 2020, and that's where the prep is for right now. I again, like, don't know if it's going to happen or not. At this point in time, I want all of you to cross your fingers. Cross? Yes. Thank you. So, you know, we're hoping that it will happen. You know, I hope to be able to just represent and get selected and go. I don't know if I'm going to win it or not, because one is that there are just very few women in the categories that we run with, because there are no quad amputees that run. If I do run, I'd be the world's first quad amputee to run. Otherwise, there are always just bilateral amputees that exist. And even being able to do that much will be great. So that's the only aspiration that I have. But with everything else, I guess the mantra is always to just take life as it comes and live with it and be happy with the smaller happinesses that we can get. Like sometimes just having too many goals that look far ahead, and you know that it's just going to take a click of a button to change the whole thing. Why bother? I mean, like, but children study, finish your degrees, important. Yeah, get a job. Yeah, okay. Like, I don't know. Last thing I'm having, like, people going back after this talk and saying, listen, you know, it doesn't matter, Shani said so. Right, yeah.
I think they'll really work hard after this. Right, students? Students today, I have had a few students because we teach communication skills. I'm talking about myself and a few faculty here. A lot of students come because it's an interactive class. A lot of students come to us and just smile, and then slowly they'll walk us to the department, and we wonder what is and why are they walking with us. And suddenly they say, ma'am, can I come and talk to you sometime? And it's and we say, okay. And they come, and then when there's nobody around, they would want to share their experiences. And then when they open up, it's very hard to even believe that they went through so much. But what has happened is today, there are a lot of cases of depression, anxiety issues. I think it could be relationship wise, and there's so much that they go through. Sometimes they even feel that one breakup, I say this with a lot of confidence and seriousness, they get really shattered. And it's very easy for us to adults to go up and say, it's okay, you can find someone. But they say, ma'am, it's very difficult to find someone. Yeah. It's not so easy. Or say, don't do anything
right now.
I think
it gets easier in your time and age, right? You have Facebook and Instagram and all of that. Like, in our times, like, you saw a guy you liked, you had to, like, follow the guy to figure out where he lives, you know, physically follow him, right? Or, like, find his name, like, you had to find somebody who studies in his school to then find his friend, and then, like, you can just Google someone these days. I'm thinking it should be easier.
There are other things that are happening. There are other things that are happening, connection to what you said just now, a question rather you asked. The answer goes this way. Geeta Maya ma'am will definitely agree with me because she's in charge of student affairs. There are a lot of things that happen, and in the age of Instagram, in the age of Facebook, which is now not so popular as Instagram, they're so very particular about how much likes do they get and not, and sometimes even miss you sometimes.
True.
So in this kind of scenario where people are, especially youngsters, are going through depression and anxiety, do you have any message for them?
I think it's going to be, it's easier when you belong to my generation, I think, because we belong to a generation that didn't have instant gratification, right? Like, you had to wait from 1 week to the next week to see what happened in that serial that you followed, right? You didn't have a Netflix where you could binge watch them back to back. So it teaches you to sometimes take a step back and wait for life to happen to you. And unfortunately, it has its advantages, I think, to be able to binge watch, I think. But what happens to y'all is that you're so used to having something on the instant, then you don't learn to take a step back. But like, what you guys need to realize, and I don't know if this helps or not, is that a year from now, what you're going through at this point in time is going to be inconsequential. And 10 years from now, you're going to turn back and say, like, what? And I've done that to myself, right? It's not like I'm sitting here, like, I've had my heart broken a few times. And then I've thought that, you know, oh my God, like, I'm never going to live without that guy, and it's going to be the end of my life. But today I look at him on Facebook and I'm saying, dude, I have a better life than you. Why? So your life is only going to get better. And nothing in your life is going to be worth taking your life, ever. But constantly, I just think that one of the biggest things that got me through the worst part of my life is having solid friends. Like having those strong friendships that really matter, right? So there was this interesting research that Harvard had done. And what Harvard did was that they mapped the life of people from right when they were 18 till they were about 80, the same group of people, right? And when they were really young, they asked them the question that what would give you, you know, what would make you the happiest person, or what do you think, how would you term that you're most successful today in life? And everyone at that point in time said that that if I was rich or if I was famous, I'm going to be happy in my life. And then they mapped the life of all these people till for however long they lived. And what they found was the people that lived the longest and lived the most happiest and content lives were people who invested, who had strong relationships. And I strongly believe that today, if I am the person that I am today, is because of the people that I've had in my life. Like, I couldn't have gotten through what I did without having that group of women around me. So I think, like, if you can get those friends, I think it makes a lot of sense.
What can I say? I think it's very hard to choose where I'm really going to choose words anymore. We've come to an end of the interview with Shalini and...
They have another page.
These are your lines from the blog.
Oh,
I'd like to read.
Okay.
So with her words, may I end. But if all of us could just accept and be proud of our scars because they stand for our journeys and triumphs mostly, the world would be a less darker place. They teach us that wounds always heal, though the scars stay. And with the time, these scars just get lighter, and sometimes accidentally, when we run our eyes or hands over them, they remind you of all the emotions that caused them. But most importantly, I hope you can remember that you have triumphed over them. Ladies and gentlemen, Shalini Saraswati.